to everyone, and welcome to this edition of Aaj Savere. India has changed tremendously in the last two decades, and you can see it everywhere. You can see it in the malls, you can see the cars, you can see the family structures. But one of the aspects that reflects it the most is fashion. There were not too many fashion designers two decades ago, and now there are so many. The way people dress, the way people buy their clothes had changed so much. And so it's really important to take a look at that. And today we're so privileged because we have one of the people who played a major role in it, someone who's considered by many as the leading fashion designer in India, Tarun Tahiliani. Tarun, thank you for being with us.
Oh, it's my pleasure to be here.
So many people actually have heard about your father, Admiral Tahiliani.
Oh, I must tell him that. I must make him watch the program. Because he's always telling me, you know, son, now people go to me and say, are you Tarun Tahiliani's father? I don't like that. And he cracks up, you know, so I always kid him. And I said, Dad, I grew up saying, everyone saying to me, are you Admiral Tahiliani's son? So tit for tat.
Exactly. So that's what I wanted to ask. Coming from an army family and that background, fashion is almost the other extreme. So how did that happen?
Well, there was no fashion. But you know the way these things happen? Because you're born with it. And you, in a way, have no other choice. And you know, kind of like water has to find its own way, or it's so much in your subconscious that it takes over your conscience, constantly being told what you have to do, as I did go through, you know, as most Indian boys did at that time. If you grew up in the late 60s, early 70s, as I did, well, through the 70s, it was always that, look, you've got to be an engineer, you've got to be, then go to IIM or preferably Harvard, because they knew three names of the top business schools abroad,
yes,
or Wharton, and you will come back and run this family business or do something. But that's a kind of path that precedes you or is laid out the minute you take birth and you're in your creche. There's this golden path laid out for you, which is every parent's dream, you know. And maybe doctors wanted their children to be doctors, or lawyers wanted to the children. It was very cut and dry. There were three or four or five, you know, kind of professions. And I mean, respectable upper middle class things that you
right.
aspired and did, you know.
Your father wanted you to be in the army, or?
Well, he did. I mean, he did suggest that as a child. Apparently, I was taken to some psychologist, Pal Padamsi, who was a famous theater person. And he tells me the story with great glee, how I drew a bunch of soldiers marching and one soldier had fallen down. And I said, that's me, I'll never wear a uniform. It's not for me or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I never had any desire to join the army, you know, or the Navy. He was in the Navy. I love ships, I love planes, I thought about being a pilot, but a commercial airliner, which he stuck his nose up at because he was a test pilot. He flew all kinds of jets, you know.
Yes.
And did loops and landed on aircraft carriers and, you know, did kind of very racy things that, you know, I suppose most young kids would dream to aspire to be like or have the experience. But anyway, so, you know, I kind of tried to do sciences and I couldn't because, you know, I couldn't after 3 years. I didn't understand how to balance an equation, you know.
Okay.
It's like you have it in your head or you don't.
Yes,
I didn't.
Yes.
And all I think I learned in chemistry was H2NO makes H2O, which I understand is water. How hydrogen and oxygen come out, I still don't understand.
Right.
I still don't understand how there can be a waterfall in the Himalayas and suddenly in Delhi you can flick a switch and the music system works. I don't understand it. You
right,
know?
Right.
How that gets stored in birth. I don't understand. They tried to explain it to me 100 times and I'm okay that I don't understand.
Right.
But I do understand other things. And these are the things that I learned through my dreams, through dreaming, through, I always loved art. I always drew processions of people and all sorts of things. And I remember when I won the best artist prize in Dune, my professor saying to me, where are you going to get in life drawing high fashion models? I mean, what is this? Like, you know, I don't know. I draw it because it comes out of me.
So since you were a child, you were drawing all the time?
Always drawing the time. My God, my teachers at Dune were mortified because, you know, the books had to go back to be circulated to the next class, and the books came back with shoes and bags and legs and heads and, you know, all sorts of things.
Right.
And I mean, I did enjoy economics. I was fine with math.
But you did go to Wharton.
Yeah, I did because, you know, I mean, I came out of school. I didn't know what to do. I tried English. I hated it because in the Indian curricula, you only studied one subject. And, you know, we studied the Book of Job and I began to feel like Job by the end of it.
Okay, okay.
And I ended up in the States doing economics and then transferred to Wharton uh-huh. to do undergraduate business. Because if you ask me, did I have really any interest in business? No. two reasons. My best friend, who I adored, was there, so I thought it'd be fun to study, you know, in the same college as him. But also, I kind of went back to the path that was laid out to me. Okay, you couldn't do engineering. Well, now you go to Harvard or this thing. Well, Harvard turned me down. So I did summer school at Stanford and went to Wharton, you know.
Okay.
And that's where I graduated from. And I came back and I then sold oil field equipment for the family business.
Yeah, that must be weird for people to associate with you with oil field equipment.
And when I tell people in oil field, this is what I did, they totally flip out, you know, because they think it's the most, I mean, you tell someone in fashion in oil field equipment, they're like, what's that? They don't even know.
Right, right.
And that's what I did. And
how much did you enjoy that?
Well, I enjoyed the challenge of kind of making something out of nothing, making these accounts work. It was kind of new to me. I mean, we used to go to all these oil equipment manufacturers of machine tools, which was my grandfather's business around India. And I really say I hated that. I didn't know whether drilling machine or lathes, you know, I didn't care. It was all this big deal about machines that made kind of holes or screws in other machines and, you know, parts. I'm just, you know, wasn't for me at all. And like how fate, you know, this thing, I was kind of quite broke. And we had this dead space in Bombay that was lying there, and my wife, who just moved back from the States with me, who's very tall and lovely, had been asked to do some campaigns. She did one or two campaigns, and Pierre Cardin came to town.
The French designer,
and he was a great couturier, and he was, you know, at his kind of peak at that time.
Yes, yes, in the 80s.
And he came to town with this absolutely, I mean, I can only say I had never seen anything before. I'd never seen a French fashion show or anything. It was exquisite. And it's like something just went bang. And actually, I don't even know if we had the money to go buy tickets. And Sal, that's my wife, went to try and be an usherer. And at the Taj, they said, man, he's coming with five models. You're very tall. Can you come for the audition? And she got picked to be one of the models. And that's how I ended up going to the show.
So you didn't have to pay for the tickets, so you could go for the
show. No. She got some money so I could buy a ticket, and she was in it. You know?
Okay.
So at least we were breaking even at the end of the weekend or something.
Okay.
So I ended up at the show. I mean, she was sick as a dog because she had never modeled before on the ramp and was not her thing. And, you know, in those days, it was a big deal. You had to run around backstage in your pantyhose and, you know, you just wear the next thing that came along, which was normal in French fashion.
But people were not used here.
Not used to it here. They're still not used to it here. My God, here. Now, if a top falls off, people go to jail. I mean, they call it a wardrobe malfunction. Hello. Anyway, so I went and it really was just, it was something like a dream. It was spectacular. It imprinted me, and it just suddenly, everything I'd drawn for years was a fit. However, I mean, I must say, in a way, it's like a duckling getting imprinted by a rooster. You know, sometimes it's the wrong thing, because to get imprinted by French fashion this early, you know, you've already grown up in South Bombay, you've already come from a very anglicized family. I mean, I'm ashamed to say that I can't even recite my numbers in Hindi till 100, because we never needed to. We learnt it, it's forgotten. Mm-hmm. And it's not a good thing. I mean, I keep telling my father, why weren't we brought up more Indian? Why did we do piano lessons? Why didn't I do sarod? I wish today I could, you know, wander out and go to, say, an Abida Parveen concert, say, you know, when they have the Jahan Khushro, and understand. I go to the dargahs. I love and yearn for things Indian, but in some funny way, of course, I'm an Indian, but the South Bombay anglicized Indian, it's Indian enough. But it's not Indian enough for me to really partake of the greatness of this country.
Right.
I insist that my children speak proper Hindi now and all, because I say, you're going to live here? It's your duty. Don't forget this anglicized, colonized thing that we all grew up in, you know?
Right.
So anyway, you know, to cut a long story short, I came back out of that show and I sketched for 3 days and I was like, wow. When I look at those clothes I sketched, because I was so imprinted by French couture, they were like clown's outfits. You know, you were again trying to design. Design or anything must exist in a context.
Absolutely,
you know?
Yes.
And, you know, evolution in a way for me is better than revolution. You know?
Right, right.
You can jump many light years ahead. But I think that if people don't understand and they throw it, maybe 100 years later someone will get up and say, yeah, that was brilliant. But that's not enough. What I want to see is to be able to change something, you know, and people need to evolve with change. Anyway, so what's resulted in this is we started this fashion store with an old machine tool showroom that the family owned, and I started to promote Indian designers. And I'm pleased to say that a lot of who I consider the well-known and you know, definitive Indian designers who have a great sense of style have been through the doors of Ensemble, which was the store we started.
It was the first multi-brand store ever in India.
Yeah, and I had never even seen Henry Bendel's in New York, but I heard that was Henry Bendel's, and I'd say to people, you know, we're doing this like Henry Bendel's. They'd look at me and say, wow, you know. But you know, like they say, if you can't dazzle them with your brilliance, baffle them with your bullshit. Little bullshit never hurt anybody.
It works. It always works.
Yeah, it always works. So we started that.
So Ensemble was a success from the beginning?
In the beginning, it wasn't a financial success, but we had the space, I mean, virtually free because it belonged to the family business. But what it was it was a psychological catalyst for something that was just beyond anything I'd ever imagined. And I'm happy for that. You know, I might not have benefited financially. And, you know, when I go into projects, financial gain is not my number one
priority.
Of course, now as I've got older and I have more commitments and I have hundreds of people, you know, I've got to be much more on the ball. But for many years, I'd say, and perhaps that's a failing because it allows for inefficiency, because you're not watching the bottom line, you know. It allows for great self-indulgence or indulgence of many sorts, and you want to do this and this must be so, and this is, you know, and oh, you know.
According to your passion of the moment.
Yeah, yeah, but it also has a great, you know, virtue in that you do things for passion, you know, and
right.
Not just because there's some, you don't compromise
right.
As much as you would if you were just.
Right.
So by the second year, it started to make some economic sense, and then it did really well. And the reason was because we all had our fantasy about what people should wear. It was beautiful costumes of Royal India. There was this whole celebration of Indian style. Because I remember in the beginning in Bombay, all these socialites would come in, but they had their little Ungaro photographs, and they all had tailors sitting in their homes. And they didn't wear that many Western clothes at that time, maybe basic pants, but no one really wore dresses. I mean, I'd say besides Parmeshwar Godridge or whatever, who was really ahead of her time, there were sequined butterfly tops and pants, and it was kind of not very chic. But they would come in and they'd have their tailor's copy saying Ungaro dress, but they'd make it into a kurta. So this large thing would waddle in. And, you know, dhoti shalwars were very much in vogue. And some mad black and white print that they bought of some, you know, store in Switzerland or London, you know, an Ungaro print. He would, on the flat pattern, and you cannot drape on the flat pattern, make this kind of draped kurta. They would just look completely mad, because then they'd have, in a European affectation, a brooch with a scarf attached to one's shoulder, you know, which they'd see women, fancy women in the West End in London go to lunch. It was very Joan Collins and Dynasty, you know.
So they were trying to imitate, they were forgetting their identity.
But you know, it wasn't a visceral thing. It was, and I've really said that, really, this is the biggest tragedy in India, because what happened was that it was a colonial hang-up, that people were still trying to be Western, okay? And you cut people off, so they were desperate to be Western. Like, I remember my mother saying, wow, look at this polyester sari. I mean, she said because it doesn't crush. And they started giving a beautiful hand loom that looked gorgeous to wear that polyester. Now, it's okay if you're jumping on a plane and you have to go to a meeting to wear a polyester sari.
Yes.
And I can understand if you're lower middle class, you take the train and you don't have time and you don't have to wash it and it looks like silk, so it looks more than it is. But we lost regard for our own wonderful craft. And the craft existed in this country for our climate and our way of life. But also, now I realize when I look back with the benefit of hindsight, that there was a cataclysmic change in lifestyle. Women were going to work. You know, there were nuclear families. They had to come home and wash. There's no time to sit. They didn't have dhobi sitting and anywhere they could.
Yes.
You know, they weren't in the village. There was a different kind of pressure in corporate India. Even if you were some junior secretary, there was competitiveness. You had to travel for 2 hours. No one wants to get to work looking crushed and miserable.
Of course. So fashion had to adapt to a changing society.
Yeah. And fashion happening on its own, I think, you know, I have many, many theories on this, which we'll come to later. But basically what Ensemble did with the designers who were there in the beginning, that suddenly it took Indian things and made them magic again. But at a very
glamorous high
end, yeah. Like people who go into dinner in 20 kilo outfits of embroidery, you know.
Yes.
Maybe that kilo, but it wasn't very practical. But it certainly was beautiful if you look back at some of the early work of Rohit Bal and Abu Sandeep and, you know, Rohit Costa. There was an excitement, there was a magic, you know.
Okay.
And it really just went whoosh, and, you know, suddenly all the BBC was covering us and the non-resident Indians are coming back and really people want to dress up. And then the notions of fit a Western thing, because it's no point having something beautiful if it doesn't fit, if you can't sing. So, you know, and concurrently over the next two decades, which it's been since it opened, markets opened up, there was more travel, people started wearing Western clothes from the West, so they understood what an amol should feel like, whatever. I mean, I remember Sal at her mehndi, someone had tried to make her some kind of kurta that was slightly off shoulder, but they didn't know how to ease it, so she looks through the mehndi and said, for the last 3 hours I haven't been able to move my arms, I can only do this with my arms. So, you know, there's no Amazing. Point doing it if it's wrong,
right.
You know, or... So all these things happened, the government of India opened NIFT, you know, people started getting, I mean, a lot happened. And in every city there were multi-brand boutiques. And because we were covered so much in the press, there were clones of what we did all over.
All over.
And that, of course, became its own, you know, deathly, kind of like a death wish. Because, you know, there's nothing worse than going to something, like I go even now in Delhi to a wedding. And I see 50 people wearing copies of what I do.
Of course.
Now, okay, I haven't benefited financially, that's one thing. But they're wearing awful copies and someone else thinks that that's what I do.
Yes.
So it's like a double whack, you know?
Right,
you
right.
know, someone's ripped you off and someone's looking at something really tacky and thinking, oh my God, this is what he does. That's pathetic. But
before we get to the copying of your stuff, we'll talk about how you got to be a designer, but we'll take just a short break and then we'll come back and also we'll look at some of your designs.
Jab maine Mohali test mein Australia ke against Brian Lara ka record surpass kiya, तो मैंने मेरा अपना हेलमेट उतारा और हेलमेट के ऊपर जो तिरंगा लगा हुआ होता है उसे चूम लिया. इतना गर्व मैंने महसूस किया कि मैं भारतीय हूं और भारत के लिए मैंने कुछ कर दिखाया. भारत मेरी पहचान.
वेलकम बैक. वी आर इन कन्वर्सेशन विद फैशन डिजाइनर तरुण तहिलियानी. सो हाउ डिड यू गेट टू बिकम अ डिजाइनर इन ऑल ऑफ दैट?
Well, so I started with this whole the multi-brand store, and I started from day one with my own little label. And I worked with this very sweet gentleman and his sister-in-law, Bapa Dhrangadra Naseem Khan, who ran a very specialized little export label. And so they would take my rough sketches and help me. And I went to FIT for summer school, and I decided within a year that I really want to design. So I actually went back to FIT.
In New York.
Yeah, to study. And
learned the techniques.
I learned the techniques, yeah. I did a very intense course for people from the trade. And I have to say, I learned a lot in the areas that I was interested in. And which is particularly draping and illustration. So I could illustrate my ideas, drape, understand patterns, understand how to fit things. I'm terrible at sewing, but I mean, I know enough about how to look at something and know if it's wrong, you know, which is the point of, it's a start. And as I started to work, you know how in any field, whether you're a painter or a designer, you have to develop a stamp, you develop a signature. A signature, yeah, of your style. And the two things that it emerged that I was very interested in or particularly drawn to was that I realized that A, we had come from a great culture of embellishment, because for centuries, we had one textile that was woven and then just embellished, whether you dyed it or dip shaded it or chicken curried it or any one a million things that Indians do with the love of labor. It was a textile industry that was draped on people. So I love the embellishment part of it. And slowly over the years, I mean, you know, the bigger you go, the more worried you have to be about what the market thinks, unfortunately, because you've got all these people to support. So in one way, you have a personal freedom because you have some money. But at another level, you're kind of trapped in kind of servicing the market. You know,
right.
You don't. There's a great freedom when you're 10 people in a design studio because you're so niche. And the more you produce and the more you do, the more it has to appeal, or the more you've got to pull in to want that somehow through your marketing perception, whatever game you choose to play. But the other thing was, and I always say this when I speak, is that if 100 or 200 years back, I parachuted out of a plane and came down to India, I could tell by the way people draped fabric which part of the country I was in, because
right.
the sari is worn in hundreds of different ways. Men didn't wear turbans. They didn't wear hats. They wore turbans.
Right.
They draped fabric on their head. Women wore pallas, you know. And there are different techniques of embellishment, obviously different textiles, and they draped fabric in different ways. And that's a huge thing. And for me, I find that draped form, So I'm drawn to like Greek sculpture, and I'm drawn to the Roman fashion because they drape the togas and the chitons, you know, just that whole thing of clinching fabric, which is to my eyes so beautiful. It can be so feminine and so masculine and so sensual, and it's different for each person. I mean, I'll say this, you know, you can get Armani, take a large Indian woman, I mean, you know,
right,
and there are many rather large Indian women, and get him to cut a pantsuit. I mean, what will he do to make her look great? And today, even today, you see a large woman, she's got her sari, whether that's some simple handloom or block printed or whatever. She's got her bindi, she might have sindoosh, all the little dots and daubs. It's still sensuous and beautiful.
Absolutely.
Now, you know, it's a piece of fabric, but if she knows how to clinch and drape it, it's divine.
Right.
You know,
that's what, how you.
Beautiful tailoring is divine too.
Right.
But if you have a big shape, it's difficult to hide. I mean, it's difficult to tailor over a lot of fat.
Right.
You know, you can kind of create some blob, but to drape with the right material is wonderful. So in my fashion, I've always talked about the structured drape, where I always look at old things, and then we try and drape, even if it's a Western dress, with the feeling of something that's wrapped or draped from it. That's very beautiful. That's kind of my look. And then the whole collage, the jewel t-shirt, a lot of things have evolved subsequently. I'm not into costume. I mean, we do a lot of bridal, which is very over the top. But in my ready-to-wear shows and all, I'm not attracted to huge costume because no one who I know is chic lives in a court. We're past the days. I mean, it's not, you know, what was that dangerous liaison, la liaison d'argent, or whatever, you know.
Right.
That doesn't exist. For me, people who dress like that are either caught in some fantasia or a time warp. It's not real. For me, a real person wants luxury, but there's also some restraint. It's the way we live.
Absolutely.
Today, you know, you might be worth millions of dollars, but you know, most people don't live in palaces, convert apartments. They might have lots of great art, not that, but there's that contemporaneous that has to come
right,
in.
Right.
So for me to see, however beautiful it might be as an installation, 150-meter kurta and all, no, it doesn't work for me.
Okay.
It's not for a life, you know. I mean, maybe you can wear it to a costume ball, but that's different.
Good. So let's take a look a little bit at your creations.
Mm. So what I'm showing you here is, I've got, one was a ready-to-wear show that I did 2 years back, and we used the idea of the kavals, and we had 30 kavals on stage, and it started with this old song, which was, and you know, it was a kind of great moment for India, and India was feeling good. It's called Hum Kisi Se Kam Nahi, you know, the great kaval, and it means that we're no less than anybody else. I mean, you know, and so the 30 kavals sang this, and while it was on, and the models were coming down the ramp, and I had everyone very clean, very restrained, lovely clothes based on, I always have references from the miniatures or Mughal clothing, however modern.
क्या करें दिल की जलन को इस मोहब्बत के चलन को जो भी हो जाए के अब तो सरस बांधा है कफन को हम तो दीवाने दिल जले जुल्म के साए में पले डाल कर आंखों को तेरे रुखसारों पे रोज ही चलते हैं हम तो अंगारों पे खाया है तब हुए हैं जवान तीर बन जाए दोस्तों की नजर या बने खंजर दुश्मनों की जुबान बैठे हैं तेरे दर पे तो कुछ करके उठेंगे या तुझको ही ले जाएंगे या मर के उठेंगे आज हम जैसे जिगर वाले कहां जख्म खाया है तब हुए हैं जवान
And we had this Kathak dancer who came in a modern Kathak costume in between, you know, and interspersed it.
Amazing.
So that was my fall winter from 2 years back. And the other show is my last is couture show, which I think you were at, just because I wanted them to show the sari drapes at the beginning and the fact that while it's very contemporary, it has a very strong, this is the couture, so this is what people wear to weddings and brides and stuff
right,
you know, so.
Amazing. Actually, looking at the models, I want to ask you something. There is this great controversy about models and anorexia and becoming thin and all of that. What is your take on that?
Well, you know,
pressure on
thin models are very easy to fit because, you know, in the olden days, fittings happened many days in advance and you wanted voluptuous women. Now the bodies have changed because women are much more active. They're exercising more. Perhaps there's a lot of hormones and food today that wasn't there 40, 50 years back. And there's this pressure because of magazines and television to be thin. Television and film make you larger. So most actors are actually much smaller in real life than they look on the screen.
I mean, absolutely,
And
people don't realize that.
They don't realize that. I mean, you see them in and you're like, wow, you know. They're like anorexically thin. And also, you know, from a fashion point of view, if I got 150 outfits to shoot for a show, and everyone comes in a kind of flat, it's much easier to fit because they conform to a shape, you know.
Yes.
So it started with that. And also, I think high fashion started with the French. And actually, a lot of you French people are very attenuated. They have broad shoulders. I mean, I've seen maybe like Inés de la Fressange and all in the flesh, long before the foreign girls came into France. Broad shoulders, very nice. I mean, the whole figure that Chanel promoted, but a much longer version. Now, because they were the center of the universe of fashion, and that went out and became an ideal, the world starts emulating that, and fatter women feel awful, and you know, everyone's trying to be anorexic here, and it's sad because there's a lot of pressure.
You see that in India a lot?
I see that all the time, where people who are large and voluptuous, still one generation back, that was considered beautiful, at least voluptuous. We're not talking blubbering fat, but that was considered beautiful and feminine.
Sensual.
And a sari sits better, you know. And, you know, when I was growing up, Hema Malini and, you know, whether it was Bindu, the cabbage, they're all very sensual, full women. I mean, even Zina Taman was a full woman.
Right.
This Western notion, and they wore Indian clothes, so it was fine. They look wonderful in size, they look great trucks. I mean, you know. So it's changed very fast. It's opening up of India. I kind of sometimes feel that by being socialist for so long and, you know, society feeling deprived, that suddenly when the floodgates opened, they wanted to be everything. You know, it's again, this colonized mentality that let me be like the rulers were, what we were deprived of, or the economically, you know, societies that were ahead. You must emulate that.
Right.
And I mean, sometimes I hear people in my children's generation talk, and I'm like, where did these lines come from? I mean, they've come from watching too much Sex in the City. It's so out of context.
Right.
It's also almost silly over here, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, Bollywood sits in Bombay, and Bollywood's very, you know, Bollywood did a lot of fantasia in the 70s and 80s. So it was all about dream sequences and this and that. And then they went after the NRI Indian because they were a big market. So it was all about Indians who lived abroad. And someone said to me, what is this? Some Karan Johar film. And they said, oh, it's about normal people who live in Victorian mansions, fly by helicopter, wear designer's clothes, and weep for half the movie. And, you
right.
know, when I watched it, it was, but it struck a chord. It was
right.
relevant to say. And then Indians start watching, then they start wanting to be like that. And then I just feel it's created a lot of confusion. Societies need to be rooted in themselves to have, and the French are. They've been that way. The English are. You know, they're quirky and they still like tartan plaids. And it's not that they don't, you know, evolve with Western, you know, they're not susceptible to trend. But they're more rooted. The Italians dress the way you can tell an Italian woman.
So you think Indians are not rooted anymore?
I mean, I feel there's been so much change so fast. First of all, the West white man. I mean, look at the whole obsession with whiteness. You know, what is that? If that's not some
yes.
derivative of the white man of somewhere. You know, the full fair, white and fair. Fair is lovely. You know, whitening nonsense. I mean, we're a beautiful color, you know. In this country, but the whole world is getting skin cancer trying to tan, and we're desperately trying to whiten our face. I mean, it's crazy, but you know, that's the reality.
Right.
You know, they moved to insular families, they moved into urbanization. There's a lot of pressure. I mean, pressures of urbanization are Western pressures in many ways. And, you know, the younger generation who perhaps grew up, you know, I mean, there's been such a, the elite is so Westernized that everyone's going to take their cue from that. And, you know, I think Bollywood has so much fantasy about that dream of people escape, that suddenly that escape, what was meant to be an escape, is an aspirational reality. So
right.
It's a very complex thing. I mean, you know.
You actually work with a lot of Bollywood stars. So how much does Bollywood influence fashion, and how much does fashion influence Bollywood?
Well, Bollywood's great to use. I mean, you know, if someone in Bollywood wears something, like 2 years later, people call me and say, can I have that Shilpa Shetty thing or whatever.
Right.
You know, because they're gods in this country. But, and I'm sure there's a huge influence. I mean, I don't know. I don't, you know, I'm kind of too cut off in my own world. And nobody in Bollywood really influences me to do anything. But I think that for a younger generation, half our population's under 25. And there's such a love. I mean, when people are so crazy about movie stars, the thing, to me, it seems that there's some kind of vacuum in their own life. I don't find this normal at all.
To project,
I mean,
so
you
much.
Can go so much, you go see a movie, you can love it. But you to be obsessed day and night with what stars are doing, I mean, to me, there's something wrong. And I think that there's, I mean, you can see that standard in our papers, in our whole covering of things. It's become like the tabloid West. Now, I mean, this all started in America. And I mean, you know, it's no secret that the average Joe Schmo on the street in America is kind of daft in a way, because they're so brought up on television culture, and they have no real, you know, it's such a hodgepodge. I mean, they might have values to work and this and that. They work in a very organized society, but in terms of general knowledge or kind of consciousness, you know.
So what is it to be Indian for you today?
I mean, I've been very privileged, you know. For me, first of all, is to acknowledge that in a country of 1 billion people, where say 500 million people are living below some poverty line that is so poor, I mean, it's not even what I call a poverty line, it's so poor, that I was born in a very nice family with great parents, you know, I had great grandparents. I mean, you know, every family has its share of ups and downs. I was educated, I was sent to the best schools, I have a wonderful family, you know. I mean, God, you know, what is the chance of that happening to somebody here?
Right.
And so to me, to be Indian now with the position that I'm in is that I need to really catch up and to stop these things from slipping away before they're lost. Because I also am in a position of influence, and I'm not doing it to manipulate or for personal gain. I'm always, you know, I'm building a new room, and it's all about going back to the Indian way of life. Not to be some kind of, you know, anachronistic, some kind of cartoon living in the past, but with the natural fibers, with the natural things to cross-ventilate. My gardens are always Indian. Now the food is being revised. I mean, to give the people who work for me, who are not so privileged very often, or come from, say, lower middle class strata, to give them self-respect, to make them feel part of something, to reward them, to, you know, we want to start canteens, we want to start buses, we want to a whole culture within that company, to make them feel like they're part of something because they're reviving and hang on to our tradition, and to make it contemporary, to make it real for our lifestyle today. I don't have my grandparents' lifestyle, you know. I mean, people might want costumes of Royal Indiana Wedding, and that's fine because that's 3 days of very grand celebration. But in their life, they're not to go back only to diesel jeans, to find alternatives that work here.
Right.
You know? What that
about,
for me used to be Indian.
Right. What about the crafts? Because I know you're very, very passionate,
I mean,
about that,
I can't
and preserving
tell you what
that.
Is possible in this country. And partly because, you know, we have this huge population. I mean, you know, you can still afford. I mean, let's say if we had 200 million people in India, would this craft be possible? No. Because then everybody would have a totally different standard of living, right? It'd be a very different company. The per capita income might have been $10,000. People are going to sit there on the floor and do embroidery. It's the reality. They're desperate because they're not educated. But now at least they've started seeing, because they see it in fashion, they see it on movie stars, which are very important to them. So it makes them feel like they're part of something, not just sitting away in social India producing for some cooperative something.
Something that has some worth.
Yeah, some worth, and you know, in what they think is worth. You know,
right.
Worth is a personal thing.
Of course.
What has worth for me may be totally different to you, right? So it's no point judging anything. It's to understand what makes it tick. I think us as designers, because we have a lot of patronage now from the, you know, upper echelons and NRIs, and now also from foreign stores, to do beautiful fine things. I mean, it's easy to mechanize everything and all. And I do that too, because I mean, you know, some things I need to sell at lower prices. But you know, there's amazing work being done in craft. I can tell you, you can do anything what the Mughals could do. You could do anything in jewelry. You could do anything at any level today. I often see, I mean, people, I mean, it revolts me. They have no respect for their stuff. They treat them like animals. They'll abuse them. We know child labor is not allowed. I mean, I have a different issue on that because everyone says it's not allowed. But if these children don't get some job or get fed, what are they supposed to do? Someone has to make a solution, no? Should they just sit on the street and die? I mean, I'd have this fight with my father all the time because we'd keep taking all these kids off the street and teach them to run and drink them. And I'd say, Dad, and he'd say, you're going to get arrested. It's against the law. And I said, Dad, well, tell me what they should do, what I should do. They worked in that chai stall from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m. They're probably not fed. They look miserable. They're like dead people serving tea. They're, you know, like cadavers. They're probably sexually assaulted. They're probably not paid. What should I do? Should I sit there and just watch it? Let someone come and let me stand there and say, yeah, look at the roles, ask them. I pay them, you know, an adult's minimum wage or more. They get overtime, they get tea, they go home at 5:30. Now you tell me, if you're standing there with the scales of justice, what would you rather, and if you were that child, what would you rather have? I said, you know, I have to do what my conscience tells me.
Right, right.
Well, I mean, these are not easy things, of course, because you can't make a role, because there'd be more abuse. I mean, I understand, I'm just saying from my point of view. But, you know, I mean, these are all issues in modern India, and part of the problem people get away with all of this is because there's another 100 million coming from our villages.
Tarun, we'll just take a short break and we'll come back to talk about all those things you're so passionate about.
जब भी महात्मा गांधी, स्वामी विवेकानंद और कबीर जैसी महान हस्तियों का नाम लिया जाता है, जिन्हें सारी दुनिया इंसानियत की मिसाल मानती है, तब मुझे बड़ा गर्व महसूस होता है कि मैं भी उसी धरती से जन्मा हूं, मैं भी उसी देश का वासी हूं। भारत मेरी पहचान है।
Welcome back to this conversation with India's leading fashion designer, Tarun Tahiliani. Tarun, can you explain to me one paradox? How come most fashion designers are men when they design actually for women?
Well, I think till, you know, very recently, till perhaps a century back, women didn't go to work. And I think men ran all the fashion houses.
Right.
You know, I think that was one thing. A lot of men who design are much more connected to their feminine side. So, you know, it's a natural thing, like a lot of artists. And I think that also, and very importantly, you know, fashion's become very real now. But till maybe say 30, 40, 50 years back, let's say maybe, you know, the American sportswear started, it was very fussy and fancy and very, you know, kind of over the top. And I think it's something that men, because they don't wear it, were great, more free to do than women. Most women designers in history, I think barring Schiaparelli, have been realists. You know, when
like
we
Chanel.
Look at books, well, Chanel, yeah. Donna Karan, Claire McFadden, you know. In India, it's Ritu Kumar. I mean, what, you know, Ritu Kumar, no woman would do what a Manish Arora does or whatever. Because, you know,
that's a great idea.
Put them into those outfits for 3 days and see what they decide.
Of course, of course.
So there's a greater freedom there, you know. Oh.
So how do you see fashion evolve? How do you see it in India?
I don't know.
In
I think it's
actually years,
a terrible moment
years.
For fashion.
Really?
Because fashion reflects society. And I think really our society in India is at a terrible crossroads.
Why do you say that?
I mean, I always say it's over materialistic, it's become nuclear. It's a loss of culture. I don't think they're great values out of our politicians or anything. I mean, you know, it's just anything goes. Rob, steal, cheat, plunder, it's okay, as long as you have money. People are constantly trying to show off. And it's all about projection. It's not about
the show off and the projection, yes.
So how can it be a great time? And you can you still divorce from your culture? And then suddenly at costumes, wedding comes, everyone wants to be costumes of royal India. So, but, you know, they need to get someone to drape their sari. They don't know how to do it. I mean, you know what I mean?
Yes.
So, I mean, I don't want to sound unduly pessimistic. I do see in the cities. I do see in traditional parts of India, it's fine because they haven't moved too far. And if one moves slowly, one adapts and moves again. That's the process of evolution, you know?
Right.
Right now, I feel it's gone too fast. I feel, see, Indians with blonde hair trying to, I mean, it's just, what are you all doing? You look ridiculous. Stop.
Keep your identity.
Yeah.
Adapt.
And if
keep
you don't
identity.
Have that from within, then nothing you, no frou-frou you can afford to buy and mask yourself, but will take anything away. I don't think.
right.
will have any meaning.
But it's interesting, things like yoga, for instance, have become more fashionable in many circles in India thanks to the fact that it was fashionable abroad. So do you think that something like that could happen for crafts and
Yeah. I mean, let me tell you, when I showed in Milan and came back, my whole label took a thing.
That's
because
it.
I just think, you know,
you have
it's
to
the
be
same
recognized
thing,
abroad to then.
Yeah. I mean, so anyway, that's the reality of what this country's psyche has gone through for 200, 300, 400 years, you know. And perhaps that takes time. I mean, I don't think these are things that we as Indians consciously do. But I think we need to sit still and try and connect with our own past and our own emotional gut and what this country really does have to offer and calm down a bit. And I think, you know, I mean, I think fashion actually is one very good expression where there's a very solid, visceral amalgamation of the two. And I'm now beginning to see a lot of people say, oh my God, after traveling, yeah, you want a great white pantsuit, maybe you need to go to Dolce & Gabbana. And that's fine, you know, it's great, you know, but I've nothing against it. But it's such good value for money over here, fashion, you know, it's such more individualistic rather than everyone looking the same. So let's
see. So do you see the younger generation understanding that?
I think they're much freer. You
know, of all the colonial, the post-colonial.
Yeah, definitely don't have that baggage, you know. But also Western popular culture is so powerful in the packaging. And then you've got Bollywood from this side, which kind of flops between the two. I don't know. I really, you know, it's beyond me. I don't really have a great answer for that.
And it's also difficult to generalize about India because many countries in one country.
And also, I mean, just going back to if I have to fault what we designers have done, so much of what we've done has been so ornate that people could only really wear it for their very special occasions. We haven't found those amazing solutions for Indians for everyday life. Our fault.
Why not?
Well, we've stayed very small and niche, you know, and it's been so craft, this thing. If I'm going to do a beautiful, amazing chicken shirt, which is probably one of the simplest things to do, well, you can't wear it every day, you know. And then by virtue of the fact that it's so labor intensive, it still becomes a little expensive.
Right.
And now with the malls and the rents and, you know, salaries going up, you know, everything's become much more expensive because those are costs are reality.
And also the moment you create something, so many people copy and then you sell less.
Actually, I mean, at some point, Chanel always said it was the greatest form of flattery. But we Indians are such good copiers, I think second only to the Chinese, I would say, that it is kind of disastrous. And, it, you know, I mean, there's always a drama with it. And then you sue people, but, you know, the judiciary is so backed up, so there's no recourse there.
Fashion is so glamorous. Many people want to become fashion designers, and there are many fashion schools.
For all the wrong reasons, yeah.
For all the wrong reasons. Why do you say that, and what would be
sell them,
your
listen,
tips?
It's, you know, don't... People think that fashion is some gorgeous thing sashaying down the ramp, you know? I mean, she's on the ramp for 45 seconds. There's been 3 months of work before, and it's not just about producing clothes. It's about looking after them, distributing them, selling, collecting money from people. Stores, I mean, PR, it's really complicated.
But it must be nice enough that you're still in it.
You know, like I said before on the show, I'm a creature of habit. I mean, you just get stuck in it and, you know, but we're looking at things critically. I don't know how long I want to do this. I mean, you know, I will do it for another 5, maybe a few more years. And then I've got many other interests. I love architecture. That was my real interest, which I never tuned into earlier. In any case, unfortunately, again, archaic laws. In India, you had to do physics and chemistry to do architecture.
Yes.
So I couldn't do it. But anyway, I'm doing a lot of interesting projects now. I love to paint. So I'm starting to do that again. And, you know, I build homes and design things and go up. So I'm doing this.
Right.
I mean, I don't want to be stuck with only one discipline. It's much more interesting, you know, variety is the spice of life. And if you can do it within a particular genre of design, you know.
Right.
Kinds of portfolios or with my different interests, that's great. I find it much more interesting, much more invigorating, because then I'm not jaded with one.
Right.
There's a freshness to going to the next day and seeing, working on something else.
Of course. But for those who still want to be fashion designers, what would
apparently
be your tip?
It's the
what
third,
would be your advice?
Yeah, it's the third what most aspirational for people. It's
really?
The third most.
Today?
Yeah, it's the thing
that says a lot about the evolution of this society.
Yeah.
Well, what would you advise them?
I mean, look, my advice is, first of all, you've got to have a strong point of view. You've got to have an aesthetic, okay? You know, please stop and think about the reason you're getting into. I think it's imperative that you have a very strong creative spark. Because, I mean, finally, you know, there's no point in me as a designer doing black jackets because the whole world does it, right?
Of course.
So when you do something, you've got to find it. Why would someone come and buy it from you? You're not going to compete on price with the other big players or the economies of scale, or you don't have their names. So you have to have a point of view, a twist to the plot. I mean, there might be many people who confuse being a fashion designer with a love, like abroad. There are people who just love pattern making, so they work for a designer.
Okay.
There are many fields within design that are very good to work in. Illustration's not such a big thing because of computers today, but pattern making, draping, seamstresses, I mean, you know, construction specialists, these all subsects. One could work in PR, one could work in manufacturing, one could work in, you know, I mean, there's so many different things. So, I mean, fashion design is kind of like the, I mean, for the one movie star, there are millions of jobs in the movies. You know, people have to start thinking about fashion like that.
Of course.
One could be a technician, one could be an editor, one could be a sound specialist or cameraman. There are many professions within film. Everyone can't be a movie star.
One last thing about the evolution of India. Your father, after being Navy chief, did many other things, and today had Transparency International and all this fight against corruption. You're very passionate about that also, and I wanted to hear you on that topic.
Well, I think it's very important, you know. I think we've got to start standing for things. You know, when you get some privilege, when you have the ability to choose where your stomachs are full, you know, and I mean, maybe I am his son, you know, I've been brought up on this diet from him, and he lives by his principles, and I always say, my God, you know, I'm not a tenth or a sliver of what he is or stands for. But, you know, if someone's being wronged, if someone's hurt, if someone is being cheated, I mean, you just don't do this, you know, because finally, you know, if everybody accepts everything, then that's what your society becomes, and it just ricochets around, you know. One, it's very easy to look at things microscopically, you know. The greater that there's been, you know, freedom, and there's been, you know, this country's opened up and people are taken to trial, the more efficiency it creates, the more freedom it gives people, the more fairness there is, you know. We became a very sick society, you know, what they call the license Raj, this and that, and maybe they were set up with great values and aspirations, but the fact is it didn't pan out this way, you know. People got licenses, and then because of the licenses, they had monopolistic situations. And I mean, everyone down to the junior engineer, to the cop, was taking a bribe. I'm like, you know, if you're going to pay a cop 5,000 rupees, of course the poor thing's going to have to take a bribe. What can he feed?
Of course.
And so somewhere the society has to turn itself around, you know. These are things that we've allowed to happen in our society. Not me individually, but, you know, and I think that younger generation's not taking this anymore. And they're going to fight. I mean, when that murder of Jessica Lal was acquitted because he had connections, and Malini Ramani went and stood up and she told her mother, I don't care what you say, I'm going to identify this man. It's my conscience before God. I mean, it was amazing that because of public pressure, somebody came back to trial and was thrown in and, you know, basically, you know, they sentenced him.
Right.
So I think that, you know, one has to do this, you know, one has to do the right thing, and everyone has different degrees. And we all, life is dilemma, you know. You're going to come to many crossroads and you don't know what to take. And sometimes you make the right decision and sometimes you might make the wrong decision for the wrong reason. And I'm not saying that I'm above it, but one must try, one must, you know, look after people, one must treat people with dignity. It doesn't matter who's in front of me, you know. You say up, you this thing, you did. I mean, I tell my children, if you don't say thank you to the person serving you, you could have been born in that village in Orissa, they could have been born here.
Right.
So I think, you know, just because there's a lot, we need to give each other that much space and dignity, because that becomes, the way we are with one another becomes eventually what our society is.
Right. So you see hope, there is hope.
I mean, I feel very despondent a lot of the time. And part of our problem is just this burgeoning population, because we never seem to catch up. You know, there's just, I mean, we've grown very well, we're an amazing country. But there's these, I mean, they've got to stop it somehow, you know, they've got to stop it.
Right.
And I mean, eventually I'm hopeful for this country. I can't say it. I lived abroad for a few years because that was when I was growing up, the big thing. And I just died every single day to be back in India. And it didn't matter what road stank or what gutter overflowed or whether there's no power. My heart and soul belong here.
On this beautiful note, we're going to end, unfortunately, this conversation. But Tarun Tahiliani, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
For being with us and sharing all those passionate thoughts.
Thank you.